Hi, this is Jacques, and this is the Editor's Toolbox. This episode, Hunt for the Wilderpeople, the use of the montage. When I say the word montage, what comes to mind? Rocky and its brilliant training montage? Footloose and its condensing of dance scenes over 80s music? Or even the hilarious Team America World Police? The roots of modern-day filmmaking largely originated in France in the 1910s to 20s. The first waves of film theory in America, Britain, Germany, and the Soviet Union heavily borrowed the French vocabulary. French writers differentiated editing into two concepts: couper, or cutting, the physical and mechanical act of putting the film together, and monter, the act of editing, of which the end product is montage. So while modern-day film theory uses the word montage to describe a very specific kind of sequence, where a series of mostly discontinuous clips are shown in fairly rapid succession, the early use of the word montage refers to what we would refer to today simply as editing. However, many of the concepts discussed in early film theory surrounding the act of editing a film are heightened in the modern-day montage, such as the Kuleshov effect. Lev Kuleshov was a Soviet filmmaker in the early 20th century, but really, he was a theoretician. He made movies, but he was more interested in the ideas of how movies worked, in particular, the psychological mechanics of the editing. So in the 1920s, Kuleshov is teaching at the Soviet National Film School, and he is telling his students that the soul of cinema is in the edit. It is in the way that two shots interact. It is often said that a movie is written three times. Once, when the screenwriter commits the story to paper, again, when the director and actors commit the story to film, and finally, when the editor constructs the story in time. This final telling of the story, the editing, is no less important than the other two, but is often the least discussed. In fact, Kuleshov argued that acting itself could be completely suborned by editing. It is not the actor that matters, it is the cut. More meaning, he says in his lectures, is created by the interaction between two shots, rather than any shot in isolation. To demonstrate this, he creates a famous editing exercise, later shown by famous English film director Alfred Hitchcock when talking about his use of the modern-day montage.
Now the third way is what one might call pure cinematics, the assembly of film, and how it can be changed to create a different idea. Now we have a close-up. Let me show what he sees. Let's assume he saw a woman holding a baby in her arms. Now we cut back to his reaction to what he sees. And he smiles. Now what is he as a character? He's a kindly man. He's sympathetic. Now, let's take the middle piece of film away, the woman with the child, but leave his two pieces of film as they were. Now we'll put in a piece of film of a girl in a bikini. He looks, girl in a bikini, he smiles. What is he now? The dirty old man. He's no longer the benign gentleman who loves babies. That's the difference. That's what film can do for you.
Or you for it.
Here's one of the most famous uses of the montage and the Kuleshov effect in one of the most famous scenes in film history, the Psycho shower scene. Director Alfred Hitchcock had to work within the confines of 1960s film censors, and as such, had to use the Kuleshov effect to display the brutal murder of his leading lady, without showing anything as distasteful as a knife piercing the skin of a nude woman. Editor George Tomasini used over 90 cuts in the 45-second attack, which incredibly effectively manipulated viewers into believing they had witnessed a far more graphic scene than was actually shown. In short, the whole scene was greater than the sum of its parts. This idea is echoed in the recent film, Hunt for the Wilderpeople. Hunt for the Wilderpeople is a 2016 film written and directed by New Zealander Taika Waititi. The film stars Ricky, played by Julian Dennison, who is a troubled orphan raised on hip-hop, sadness, and rejection. He is placed by Child Protective Services with the latest in a series of foster families, this time on a farm a long way away from the city, where he styles himself as a modern-day gangster. However, his foster aunt Bella, played by Rima T. Wiata, shows Ricky familial and honest love and affectionate mockery for one of the first times in his life. However, when Auntie Bella dies, the government tries to steal back the life that Ricky has come to love. Ricky then finds himself on the run in the bush, with Bella's grizzled husband, Heck, played by Sam Neill, and a dog called Tupac. Gradually, the two misunderstood outcasts, who only had Bella in common, find a kinship, united against the authorities that hunt them down. Throughout the movie, Waititi uses the editing technique of the montage and the one-shot montage to develop the story in a condensed amount of time, and to subliminally create emotional weight and subtext in a scene where the whole scene is greater than the sum of its parts. In the opening scene of the movie, Ricky, played by Julian Dennison, and Rachel House's character, Paula, the Child Protective Services officer, are on their way to place Ricky with his new foster parents, or should I say, foster uncle and auntie. The camera in this introductory scene frames both characters in extreme close-ups, purposefully obscuring the two characters. However, this introductory montage of the drive to Ricky's new home purposely frames the character of Paula as an obedient, powerful policewoman, and Ricky as an evil boy. The montage opens up with an extreme close-up of a police badge, followed up by a tapping of a pen, and then Paula turning around from a low angle. This subconsciously illustrates to the audience that Paula is a powerful authority figure and is trying to bring justice to the world. Then, after these three shots, the camera lingers on Ricky's hands, jacket, and him looking out of the window from a high angle. This tells the audience that Ricky is lesser than Paula and is both less powerful and guilty, as the differing shot lengths makes Ricky's shots feel more awkward and unsure of where to go. By pairing the two shots of Paula turning around from a low angle and Ricky moving his thumb from a high angle, the audience subconsciously links the two shots and sees the two characters as two incorrect stereotypes. Though the audience may not consciously recognize the association between the two shots, their brain certainly does and makes assumptions as to who these characters are. Through this association, the montage effectively uses the Kuleshov effect to illustrate to the audience the stereotype that Ricky is pure evil and has no redeemable qualities, and that Paula is incredibly powerful and works for justice, two stereotypes that the film effectively subverts. As the scene progresses, Rachel House's character Paula, the Child Protective Services officer, begins to list all of Ricky's offences that make him a real bad egg, including
disobedience, stealing, spitting, running away, throwing rocks, kicking stuff, defacing stuff, burning stuff, loitering, and graffiti. And that's just the stuff we know about.
This montage of Ricky's disobedience strongly highlights one of the most obvious role of the montage, the ability to condense a large amount of time into its most important elements, for the narrative's benefit. Through leaving out the context surrounding Ricky's actions and skipping past large sections of his life, the film effectively gets its point across in both as little time as possible and as comedically as possible. However, by condensing the time in the narrative, the events of Ricky's life are subconsciously projected to the audience through Paula's viewpoint, removing the cause of the bad behavior by removing the context surrounding it, and just seeing the result of, what we later learn, is Paula's errors. The montage takes the humanity out of Ricky and makes him seem as though he has no redeemable qualities and is pure evil. Through the use of the montage in this way so early on in the introduction of the character, the audience sees Ricky as a real bad egg and not as a human whose poor actions are a result of his situation. In the New York Times' Anatomy of a Scene, Taika Waititi explained the creation of a one-shot montage in his film. At this point in the film, the characters of Ricky and Heck have been on the run for a couple of months. They're really feeling the pressure of the mounting search and the government trying to bring them in. At this point, Waititi uses an in-camera one-shot montage to show the passing of time and to recap on all the characters that have been involved in the film.
So we basically put the camera on the tripod and we planted it in the ground and we just slowly turned the camera 780 degrees and hid all the actors beneath the camera, up in the bushes and stuff. And each time we passed the camera by an actor, we would, either an actor would pop up into frame or they would run around the camera to take place for another pass. We also had a fire that was going in the beginning and then someone would run in and put that out. We had doubles who were in different costumes and stuff, so we had like, I think in the end we had like three Hex and three Rickies in the shot, the real ones and then two doubles each.
By utilising the one-shot montage, Watiti condenses the passage of time into a 780 degree pan rather than a conventional montage. It shows both the progression of the characters in the scene, moving from place to place over many months, as well as the progression of a singular location in the snow over many, many months. Kuleshov was being purposely dramatic about the all-consuming power of the edit in creating the meaning of film, the ability to erase the actor, but only by a little bit. This quirk of our brains, this perception of continuity and relation between two or more disconnected images, is second only to the perception of motion itself in how fundamental it is to the very structure of cinema. Taika Waititi has successfully harnessed the power of the montage and the one-shot montage for narrative, emotive, and subliminal effect by subliminally creating emotional weight and subtext in a scene where the whole scene is greater than the sum of its parts. Thanks for watching.
Ricky Baker, now you are 13 years old. You are a teenager and you're as good as gold. Ricky Baker, oh. Ricky Baker, happy birthday. Once rejected, now accepted by me and Hector, we're a trifecta.